Hello, good morning, brothers and sisters and friends. Welcome you all to Cardiff Chinese Christian Church English Service. And special warm welcome for any one of you who are new to us, whether you are in Cardiff or in anywhere in UK or even across the world, our warm welcome to all of you. And now, as we know, in Wales, in Cardiff, we are still under the lockdown due to the COVID-19. May I continue to urge you, to invite you to join us in prayer, to pray for the situation. May God's grace and mercy be upon us all. May God help us how to be a powerful Christian witness during these days. Also, now is the time for our online greetings. So may I invite you to get your phone ready. Go to our church WhatsApp group, or maybe your very own church. If you have also your own WhatsApp group, I would encourage you all to go to your church WhatsApp group, and whenever you're ready, to send our greetings to one another. Okay, so let's put down our phones and prepare our heart and mind to praise and worship our Lord Jesus Christ. And this morning, I would like to read Old Testament passage taken from Nehemiah chapter 9, verses 5 to 6. Nehemiah chapter 9, it says, "Stand up and praise the Lord your God, who is from everlasting to everlasting. Blessed be your glorious name, and may it be exalted above all blessing and praise. You alone are the Lord. You made the heavens, even the highest heavens, and all their starry hosts, the earth and all that is on it, the seas and all that is in them. You give life to everything, and the multitudes of heaven worship you." Let's all bow down our heads and pray together. Dear Lord God Almighty, dear Lord Jesus Christ, indeed we come before you, Lord. We praise and worship you, for your name is most worthy of our praises, God. For you are the creator of heaven and earth, but God, you are also the creator of life. Our very own creator, that God, you have given us this breath of life. And for this, Lord, we give thanks to you. And Lord Jesus Christ, we also thank you for your great salvation, so that today our sins can be forgiven, that today our relationship with God, our Creator, can be repaired and reconciled. So Lord Jesus, dear God Almighty, we thank you, we praise you, and Lord, we will dedicate this following time into your hand as well, as we're going to praise and worship you. But God, we also continue to remember this world, all the pain and suffering that is going on, and especially with the COVID-19, God, we pray for your grace and mercy to be with us. In the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, we ask and pray. Amen. So now let's read the Apostles' Creed together, and then I shall pass the time to our worship team. Let us read the Apostles' Creed together. Ready? 1, 2, 3. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sits on the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From there he shall come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Hello everyone, I hope you're keeping well. I want to share a Bible verse with you. It's in Psalm 27 verse 1. It says, "The Lord is my light and my salvation. Whom shall I fear? The Lord is my stronghold of my life. Whom shall I be afraid?" On Saturday evening, our kids has joined the church online light party to celebrate the life of the world, Jesus, instead of Halloween, even though we are living an unprecedented time right now. The Bible does encourage us, the Lord is our salvation and also is a stronghold of our life. Whom shall be afraid? So we can also leave everything to him in prayer. This is a time of worship. Shall we all rise and sing our praise to our Lord? Let's all pray. Dear Lord Father, thank you, Father, for you giving us have a lovely time even though we've been locked down. Thank you, Father. We can still worship you in the YouTube channel. We can bring your church into our home. And also we can also worship you wherever we are. May your Holy Spirit to help us and fill in our rooms and also teaching us to how to worship you in spirit and in truth. Thank you, Father, that you give your Son, Jesus Christ, to live and die for us, Lord. You did this not because we deserve it, but because you love us. We also pray for someone who come with worry or feeling lost or alone. We pray, Lord, that you can comfort them and also give them extra strength and hope and joy. And also your Holy Spirit enable us to worship you as you deserve. Father, also we pray for Pastor Peter. We pray, Lord, that you will, your Holy Spirit will equip him and bring out your message to us today, Lord. And pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
sorrows, Lamb of God, by His own betrayed. The Son of Man and Brother of God has been on Jesus' land. Silent and He stood accused, beaten, mocked and scorned, bowing to the Father's will. Salvation, where's your love poured out for me? Now my soul cries out, hallelujah, praise and honor unto thee. Son of heaven, God's own Son, to purchase and redeem, and reconcile those rarest ones who nailed Him to the tree. Oh, the broken cross, my salvation, let your love pour out for me. Now my soul cries out, hallelujah, praise and honor unto thee. Now my debt is paid, it is painful by the precious blood that my Jesus spilled, that my curse of sin has no hold on me. Whom the Son sets free, oh, this freedom indeed. Now the debt is paid, it is paid in full by the precious blood that my Jesus spilled. Now the curse of sin has no hold on me. When the Son sets free, all is free indeed. Oh, the broken cross, my salvation, where your love poured out for me. Now my soul cries out,
stone it rolls away. Behold the empty tomb. Hallelujah, God be praised. He risen from the grave. Oh, the broken cross, my salvation. Love poured out for me. Now promises I see in me will be stripped away by the power of your love. Hold me close, let your love surround me. Bring me near, draw me to your side. And then the power of your love. Lord, unveil my eyes, let me see you face to face, the knowledge of your love as you live in me.
This is time for offering. Offering is a privilege and responsibility as a Christian. We can still take part of the offering by the bank transfer. If we require the bank details, you can contact me. We pray for offering. Dear Lord Father, thank you, Lord, for your kindness gift and your abundant blessing into our life, Lord. Thank you, Father, you're the good Father and you always give us a good gift. We pray, Lord, that we return the portion of the money to you as our offering, Lord. Pray, Lord, that you will accept our offering and also you give the wisdom to our church to use the money to expand in your kingdoms. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. So I pass the time for the Bible reading, Amy, and also afterward we will pass the time to Pastor Peter for share the message to us.
Today's Bible reading is taken from Philippians chapter 4, verses 4 to 9. Rejoice in the Lord always. I will say it again, rejoice. Let your gentleness be evident to all. The Lord is near. Do not be anxious about anything, but in everything, by prayer and petition, with thanksgiving, present your requests to God. And the peace of God, which transcends all understanding, will guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus. Finally, brothers, whatever is true, whatever is noble, whatever is right, whatever is pure, whatever is lovely, whatever is admirable, if anything is excellent or praiseworthy, think about such things. Whatever you have learned or received or heard from me or seen in me, put it into practice, and the God of peace will be with you. This is the word of God.
Hello, dear brothers and sisters and friends. As we come to study the word of God, let's start with a word of prayer. So let's all bow down our heads and pray together. Dear God, dear Lord Jesus Christ, we give thanks to you, Lord, for this day that we can come together in your name to praise and worship you, but at this following time to come to study your word, the Holy Scriptures, the Holy Bible. So therefore, God, we ask and pray that you will grant us wisdom and strength coming from you, Lord, so that we may understand the scriptures, the passage we are looking at today, but also knowing how to apply them into our daily life, especially, Lord, during these days of difficulties, during these days of worries, anxiety, and chaos that's going on in this world. So, God, in you we trust. In the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, we give thanks and pray. Amen. So today we'll carry on our current theme of study, which is In God We Trust. And now reaching the month of November, we are sort of halfway through our current series. So this is my prayer that I really pray for the past few sermons. They have been helpful and fruitful for you, especially in this topic of In God We Trust. May God himself, not necessarily through me or through the other preachers or speakers, but God himself has been speaking to all of us, me included as well, on this topic of how we can trust in him, how God is always faithful to us in the midst of our troubles. So today, in this second half of our series, we're going back to the New Testament. We're going back to Apostle Paul in one of his very well-known passage is from Philippians chapter 4. So therefore, let's now dwell deeper into this passage and let's learn together how we can truly trust our Lord Jesus Christ. We're going to start our sermon by sort of building a scene or a scenario, setting a background. So I would like to sort of imagine a scenario like today, if we have Apostle Paul in front of us, whom we can interview him, ask him questions. And the questions we're going to ask him is, Apostle Paul, in the midst of all these difficult moments, this trial, this persecution, these hardships, how do you cope with them? How do you deal with these pain and sufferings that you encountered? And I believe this is a very legitimate question that all of us we would like to ask him, especially in the current situation that we're constantly saying, that current situation we're living, we really would like to know the answer. And of course, we'd like to ask Apostle Paul, if possible, like, how do you do it? Well, to be honest, this question is not very far off from the original context of this Philippians chapter 4. Because in Philippians chapter 4, when Paul was writing this letter to the brothers and sisters in Philippi, to the Philippians, he was indeed doing the same thing. He was trying to encourage them, to share with them how he dealt with, coped with these difficult moments. And hopefully that will become a source of encouragement for the brothers and sisters in Christ, for them to continue to trust in God like he did. So if we ask Paul this question, how do you do it? How do you deal and cope with the hardships? And Paul, based on the scriptures that we have today, Philippians chapter 4, I would say Paul's answer will come up with, there are three steps. Three steps that Apostle Paul always took in order for him to be able to cope with all these difficulties. Three steps. And the first step, so imagine these three steps as if in the three legs of a tripod that will sustain and hold Apostle Paul together. So the step number one is verse 4. Philippians chapter 4 verse 4, which reads, rejoice in the Lord always. I will say it again, rejoice with an exclamation mark. So you know, therefore, Paul was writing it, but he was writing it, expressing it with power and strength and with passion to say, guys, rejoice. That is something very challenging, interesting to say the least. Because again, the question is, Paul, how do you cope with your hardships and difficulties? And Paul will start his answer by telling us step number one, rejoice in the Lord. Maybe we'll say, are you kidding me? Especially if this comes directly or straight from me. Maybe brothers and sisters and friends, you may even challenge me right here to say, Peter, despite you are the pastor and everything, yeah, but Peter, what do you know about hardships? What do you know about pain and sufferings? Have you been through the same hardship that I am currently going through? So brothers and sisters, if yes indeed, if this only comes straight from me and say, yeah, just rejoice in the Lord, sometimes you may come across, wow, this is too model answer. But however, I would like to start my sermon with Paul saying it comes from Apostle Paul. God inspired him. God worked in his life for him to write this down to me. Why is it so important? I'm appealing therefore now to Paul's very own experience and his authority as an apostle. Paul, in his own words, 2 Corinthians chapter 11, verses 23 to 29, this passage, I've quoted it beforehand with the same reason, to really appeal to Paul's very own testimony instead of mine. 2 Corinthians chapter 11, we pick it up from verse 23. It says, Paul said the following, I have worked much harder, been in prison more frequently, been flogged more severely, and been exposed to death again and again. 5 times I received from the Jews the 40 lashes minus 1. 3 times I was beaten with rods. Once I was pelted with stones. 3 times I was shipwrecked. I spent a night and a day in the open sea. I have been constantly on the move. I have been in danger from rivers, in danger from bandits, in danger from my fellow Jews, in danger from Gentiles, in danger in the city, in danger in the country, in danger at sea, and in danger from false believers. Verse 27, I have labored and toiled and have often gone without sleep. I have known hunger and thirst and have often gone without food. I have been cold and naked. Besides everything else, I face daily the pressure of my concern for all the churches. Who is weak? And I do not feel weak. Who is led into sin? I do not inwardly burn. So you see, in 2 Corinthians chapter 11, Paul has given us, may I dare say, his resume, okay, his CV, his portfolio, not about his successes, but about his maybe failures, about his hardships and troubles and pain and suffering. And also furthermore, the very moment that Paul was writing this letter of Philippians, when he was writing these words to the brothers and sisters, to the Christians in Philippi, do you know where Paul was at that moment in time? Well, he was literally inside a prison. Not to visit prisoners, but he himself being a prisoner. So in other words, at that moment in time, when Paul was actually writing this Corinthian as follows, Philippians chapter 4, to say, rejoice in the Lord always. I will say it again, rejoice. He was literally a prisoner. So, all these coming from Paul, coming from someone with a first-hand experience with a lot of sufferings and trials and pain. So for me, whenever I read the following things to come, I will pay a lot of attention, because whatever is written there, it comes from a guy who knew what he was writing, who knew what he was going through. So now let's come back to his first step. Still challenging, despite him having a very strong background of experience and pain and suffering, but still for him to say, rejoice in the Lord always, it's still tough for us. So therefore, let's spend a little bit of time to try to understand this keyword rejoice, or this concept of rejoice. And I'm sure previously in a lot of sermons on this passage, or even Bible study on this passage, we know already a lot about this term rejoice, what it is and what it isn't. So what if it is not? Rejoice. Let us not be confused or misunderstand. Rejoice in the scriptures, in the Bible, rejoicing is never, never, never about being happy, smiling at all times, or laughing, or even laughing at our very own difficulties, mocking, downplaying it. Nothing like that. Rejoicing, dear brothers and sisters and friends, as we know it, it is never about just simply being happy, smiling, laughing. It's not about being naive, ignorant, or super optimistic. Instead, what rejoicing means, it will consist of this, despite going through hardships. Despite going through hardships, Christians, we still have this strength. This strength, this inner peace, this power coming from God helping us to go through the hardships we're going through, to giving us this power, this ability to pull ourselves together, to buckle up, to soldier on, to pull through, endure through the hardships, and seeing the end of the tunnel, to say, at the end, everything will be okay. Everything will be fine in the Lord. That is rejoicing. Meaning is when have this inner peace. Outside may be a storm going on, but we still know that strength and hope, knowing things will still be okay. So therefore, I have the ability to face the storm and endure, persevere till the end. So as you can see, it's nothing to do about being naive or ignorant or just keep on laughing, smiling at all times. But it's more about this inner peace, inner strength, and hope that comes from our Lord Jesus Christ. And moving on in verse 5, Paul also didn't stop at just rejoicing. Verse 5, let your gentleness be evident to all. The Lord is near. So here you see, Paul was moving on. He started off by saying, rejoice in the Lord always. But then that doesn't mean it's just merely an inner a strength, as I said it. It's not just an inner feelings or emotions that we have inside. But what is inside us, Paul is implying here is, for him is also saying, let this be expressed outwardly. So that this inner strength, it will come out of us and be expressed in verse 5 through gentleness. Gentleness through gentle words, gentle actions, gentle mind, attitudes, and you can easily equate this or expand in the same list. It's gentleness spanning into love, kindness, patience, understanding. So what Paul is saying is, when we have this rejoice in actual action, real action, it will be expressed through gentleness, but also similarly to love, kindness, and patience, which is the very, very opposite of anger, for example, or losing our temper, or being impatient, or even finding ourselves spiraling down and eventually finding ourselves into depression. So Paul is saying rejoice is inside but expressing outwardly. And Paul, he's also a man with, you know, with word into action. Because if we look at Acts chapter 16, another passage that I'm sure you will know it very well. Acts chapter 16, picking up from verse 22 to 25, the context was Paul and his companions. In this case, it was Silas. They were preaching, sharing the gospel of Jesus Christ, and they encountered opposition. People who disagreed, attack them, persecute them even. Picking up from Acts chapter 16, verse 22. The crowd joined in the attack against Paul and Silas, and the magistrates ordered them to be stripped and beaten with rods. After they had been severely flogged, they were thrown into prison, and the jailer was commanded to guard them carefully. When he received these orders, he put them in the inner cell and fastened their feet in the stocks, in chains, bounding them. About midnight, Paul and Silas were praying and singing hymns to God, and the other prisoners were listening to them. And it's a very fascinating an interesting event, which I encourage you to keep reading in your own time, Acts chapter 16, verses 22, 25 onwards. You will see what happened next. But here for our context, you will see when Paul said, rejoice in the Lord always, especially rejoice in your times of difficulties, and this rejoicing expressed outwardly into gentleness, kindness, love, patience. There you see in Acts 16, that was exactly what happened. So when Paul said it, he can even come up with his very own examples to back himself up, to say, I have actually done it, and to how to rejoice in action. So summing up this first step, rejoicing in the Lord always, not meaning being happy, laughing at all times, but having this inner peace, strength, hope coming from our Lord Jesus Christ, but also not just an inner feeling or emotion, but expressed outwardly through gentleness, kindness, love, and patience. So now the question for us is, but how do you do that, Paul? Your first step is already very challenging. It's easier said than done. How do you do it? So now we're going to move on to his second step. And the second steps that Paul had for to deal with troubles and difficulties is verse 6. In verse 6, it says, do not be anxious about anything, but in every situation, by prayer and petition, with thanksgiving, present your requests to God. So that is Paul's second step. And this is summed up as pray, pray, and pray. Pray at all times. Pray under all circumstances for anything and everything that happened to us. So that is Paul's second step. And right there, I understand many of us may even say, well, Pastor Peter, that is a model answer. Okay, we all know that Christians, okay, when we go through difficulties, of course we pray to God. And sadly enough, sometimes when we heard so much of this, like pray and pray and pray, like, I know. And that becomes numb. We become numb to it, and it's kind of just come in here and goes out there, and we say, oh, just, I know that. And sometimes we may even say, but I have done it. I have tried it, but things didn't work out. Or I have been trying so hard, and it is really difficult to maintain. And to add on top of such a challenge, when Paul said in verse 6, but in every situation, that is Paul's context. It's not saying just pray, pray, and pray, but Paul says pray at all times, for all circumstances, anything and everything that happened to us, we convert that, we change that, we turn that into a prayer to God. And here for us, and on my observation and chatting with a lot of the brothers and sisters in Christ, and sometimes including myself as well, a lot of time when we say, but pray in every situation in our life, that is near impossible. And to support our answer that it's impossible to pray in all every situation, usually I can sum it up into two reasons we normally explain it. The first reason is, well, if every single daily life matters so small, I still need to pray to God, that I'm not going to bother God with that because they're so tedious, like tiny. Why would I go and pray to God about all these daily life matters that's going on? Firstly, daily life matters too small. Let's not bother God. Secondly, if in every situation we pray, then prayer will become very repetitive. There are so many things that it's as if every day I will go back to God and pray about the same thing again, again, and again. And why? Because that's so repetitive. I am not going to nag, to pester God, to trouble him and bother him so much, because it's just every day so repetitive. Brothers and sisters, haven't you ever given these two reasons to kind of sum up into major categories? When we say pray in every situation, and our response is that is near impossible. But then, brothers and sisters, if I may say the following thing, what if, now imagine, what if we said that to God, and God actually came back to us in response, in reply, to say, you know what, my dear child, I don't mind I don't mind. In fact, it's not just I don't mind, but in fact, I really liked it that you come to me in prayers for every single thing, no matter how small they are in your life. And also, I don't mind you keep repeating them to me repetitively. And like God said, I have time, I have eternity, and I am God, okay? So leave that to me. No need to worry for me. Brothers and sisters, imagine if God does actually come back to us and tell us he doesn't mind at all. We go to him for every single, no matter how tiny those issues are or how many times we repeat ourselves. What would we say? My brothers and sisters, you know, that I asked myself those questions before, and I will say it was a reality check for me. A reality check for me, because should that really happen? I'm kind of like, okay, what should I say? And come to realize my real reasons, the true reasons behind all these very nice packaging words of saying, oh God, you know, I don't want to trouble you. Oh God, I don't want to nag you or pester you. Behind all these, the reality I realized was, first of all, when we say the daily life matters, that's too small. God, I'm not going to pray to you because I don't want to trouble you. That's too small. Reality fact checked is, because God, should I present all these things to you? Not only there are so many of them, but the real truth is, in fact, I may not. In fact, it's I don't want to present them all to you in prayers, kind of like seeking your input, seeking your thoughts, your will, your expectation, your guidance. I said, God, that is too much for me. God, in fact, if every single matter in my life, I pray to you, God, is intrusive. God, you are intruding into my privacy. There are areas in my life, there are matters in my life. God, in fact, I don't want you to be involved. Likewise, brothers and sisters, when we say repetitive prayers, God, I'm not going to nag you. Similarly, the reality sometimes is, it's not about nagging God. It's us. We don't want to nag ourselves. We don't want to go through that repetitiveness because it is a chore. Like prayer become a chore. Like, God, I just don't want to go through this pain and tedious way of repeating myself every day. Haven't I already told you, God, the other day, you hurt me, so just get on with it. Why do I need to keep on repeating myself? Brothers and sisters, these may sound very harsh, but if we are honest with ourselves, maybe, just maybe, sometime that is the reason why when Paul said, in every situation, let's present ourselves to God in prayers, we find it challenging. Not because we don't want to nag God or bother God. No, the truth is simply, God, I don't want that much of you in my life. Let us therefore be reminded of this. And moving on, what Paul is hinting to here is not just about in every situation just go to God, but what Paul is trying to tell is, well, our prayer, therefore, let them not be a model answer type of prayer. A lot of time our prayer, on one hand, we don't really want all these God to be involved in all of this. So what happens for Christians, a lot of time, we become sort of model answer, meaning we just pray in a very robotic way. But Paul is telling us that is not what we are supposed to do. We are not supposed to just pray as a model answer, but pray in a meaningful and fruitful manner. A prayer with proper substance, motives, and direction. Just like James in chapter 4, verse 3, reminds us similarly. James in chapter 4, he says, when you ask, you do not receive because you ask with wrong motives, that you may spend what you get on your pleasures. So that one, James chapter 4, is not only because we pray with the wrong motive, a sort of a selfish desires or ambition, etc. Well, that may be true, but the also important point is we pray, we ask with the wrong motive, with the wrong mindset, with the wrong attitude. So how to pray properly? How to pray in a meaningful, fruitful manner? Carry on with verse 7 of Philippians 4. Verse 7, it says, "And the peace of God that transcends all understanding will guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus." So the first half of it, like, "and the peace of God," that link us back to the rejoice. It's because when we pray and we keep on praying for anything and everything, we submit that to God. And that is how we will experience. We will experience this inner strength, inner joy that comes from God and making us able to rejoice. Okay, that's my previous point. So the peace of God, that links back. But then it's the last part of this. Will guard your heart and your mind in Christ Jesus. That is through prayer, not a one-off prayer, but a persistent prayer. And we, like Christ himself, will guard our hearts and our minds. So what does that mean? How can Christ guard our hearts and our mind? Guarding us, protecting us. Two aspects. The first one is guarding us and protecting us from being overwhelmed by the situation. That is straightforward application, especially back to our context of hardships, pain, troubles, and difficulties. A lot of time when this happened, it was so overwhelming that we will be sort of affected. It's kind of like a heavy load upon us that will even be dictated by this, like kind of being a string, like pulling us around, going in all kinds of directions, causing maybe panic in us, worries, fear, anger, frustrations, the list goes on, and ultimately hopelessness and despair in us. So this is what the immediate implication, Christ Jesus, through our persistent, continuous prayer, that he will guard our heart and our mind, that he will protect us from going into those dark areas where we only find is hopelessness and despair. He will protect us from there. So that turning that the other way around is when we praise to God. When Paul said, my step two, if step one is rejoice, step two is pray, pray, and pray, he will start his prayer by saying, God, all these are happening to me, but God, I pray, first of all, you will protect, you will guard my heart and my mind against all these, so that I will not be overwhelmed and sort of defeated, that I will not be dictated, affected by all of this, but still, God, in you, I trust. And guard and protect goes deeper as well. Even another more important reason, which I really want you to listen carefully now. When God says in Christ, will guard and protect us, it's not only protecting us from all those negative feelings and stuff like that, but more importantly, protecting us from distorting the true meaning and power of prayers. That is what Jesus Christ is also helping us to do through our continuous prayer. Distorting the true meaning and power of prayers? What do I mean by that? Well, let's go back to the basics. Basic of Christianity. Christianity 101. If I ask the simple question, what is prayer? If we take away all the spiritual wordings, or even may I dare say, take away the jargons, okay? What is prayer? The simplest definition of prayer is talking and speaking to God. Engaging in a conversation with God. A two-way dialogue. That is prayer. And this is the true meaning and power of prayer. That this unique honor, this privilege that's been given to us by God. That prayer is our way of interacting with God. With a God who is active, who is close to us. A God who really wants to take part in our life. That God wants to be present in our life and not sort of an absent God. No, God wants to be there for us and with us. And prayer is the powerful tool God has given us to interact with him. Prayer is our way to grow and deepen our relationship with God. Such a powerful instrument. And no wonder why. Our spiritual enemy, he knows it, and he tried his very best to sabotage it. The question I will ask, brothers and sisters, when was the last time you had a proper conversation with God? When was the last time you had a meaningful chat with God? Because sadly enough, even with me, self-reflection, sadly enough, far way too often, we have intentionally or unintentionally, but the fact remains, we have downgraded, we have diluted our prayers to a mere shopping list. A list of God, please help me, do this, do this, do this, do this, do this. Nothing else, nothing more. Just a mere shopping list. That is how our spiritual enemy, as I said, he knows perfectly the power of prayer, and that is why he tries very best to sort of lead us astray so that we will only treat prayer as shopping list, not really a conversation we engage, we interact with God. Let me give you an illustration of my point here. Imagine if you have a friend. This friend of yours, he or she, always just ask you to do this, to do that. Maybe ask you to give her this, or lend him or her this or that. That is all. And afterwards, when you have sort of fulfilled the demand, he or she will just disappear. No contact at all. Even you text him, WhatsApp and everything, nothing. He or she never answer your call. But next time round, when he or she needs your help again, he will just magically reappear. Will send you a text, send you a call, even come to visit you personally, and only to ask you for your help again. Can you do this, do that for me? Now imagine you have such a friend. What will be your view? How would you treat this? Do you even call that a friendship? Proper conversation with a friend, as we know it, is about this interaction, two-way dialogue. Like even using this case is, if a friend you haven't seen for a long, long time, like you will update on each other. Maybe you will start sharing, updating what happened in your life and so on and so forth. But eventually, in a proper conversation with a friend, you will say, okay, enough of me talking now. What about you? How have you been? Tell me. I'm here eager to listen to you as well. So that it's not just me one-sided, keep on talking, keep on demanding stuff. We know it in our friendship, human friendship. We know what a proper conversation looks like. Likewise, application, brothers and sisters, our conversation with God. If we apply this in a more practical way, in the context of this series, In God We Trust, in the midst of our difficulties, holding a conversation with God in the midst of our difficulties, maybe again, we may start by downloading our issues to God, telling him, God being our listener. But then God being our listener, being our friends, but also we know God is our teacher, he's our advisor, he's our God, he's our master. So a proper conversation will also include, God, enough of me talking. What do you think? What do you say, God? God, I'm here with open ears, I'm all ears, Lord, to listen to your feedback. Is there anything you want to tell me? Is there anything I need to change? And so on and so forth. Like you are, in other words, a conversation is this communication of doing things together, talking through things together. Even again, the midst of a difficulty we're facing, holding a meaningful conversation with God is together with God. You sort of analyze the situation together. Like, why am I in such a trouble? What was the cause? Okay, what happened? God, let's figure this out together. Help me, God, to figure it out. And also coming up with solution, action plan. Like, God, okay, we are engaging in this now, but how do I go out from here? How do I move forward? God, please, let's come together, work together for a solution. Action plans that I will put together, but God, you are with me in it so that we do this together. That is what, in the context of hardship and difficulties, having a conversation is this dialogue that is going on instead of only a request list. And now to push it even further into reality. Okay, like, but how does that even work in real life? Because rarely do we actually hear God speaking to us directly. Okay, so with that, the final practical step here is, it's important for us. How do we even hear God? Understand what does he think? What does he say? Well, we all know, again, Christianity 101, we know the importance of Bible. God has already given us the Holy Scriptures to tell us who he is, his character, his personality, things he likes, he doesn't like, and so on. There's so much wealth in the Bible. And that is why there's no shortcut, brothers and sisters, in Christ. We do need to know the Scriptures. If necessary, get help, get tools, whether get yourself some commentaries, okay, or ask pastors, leaders, mature Christians to help you out together. You study the Scriptures together. Secondly, that is my own experience. I will also encourage you, maybe try this out as well. How do I really engage in a conversation with God in prayer? For a long time, I have kept what I would call a prayer diary. It works as just similar to the other diary, meaning you record, you write down things that happen to you. But as a prayer diary, of course, that means is I write down my prayers to God and keeping track of things. And then I write down my prayers, I write down my responses to God, I write down even scriptures that I think during that conversation, maybe certain scriptures will appeal to me. I wrote all of them down. And then when I read them back, I find that really, when you add all these together, it's really a conversation, a dialogue that's going on. It's not just me talking about all my stuff. In my prayers, there will be those moments of, as I said, like, God, what do you think? There may be moments of silence, moments of pause. Maybe scriptures will come along, maybe a day or two later. If we refer back to the Old Testament, the Psalm, last week, Pastor Jonathan Harris preached on the Psalm already, and that similar, the Psalm 13, is a similar, kind of like a spiritual diary, a prayer diary. That, my brothers and sisters, if you want a practical way to learn, practice how to nurture a meaningful conversation with God, start from there. So summing up the second point, Paul is saying his second step of dealing with hardships and trouble is the power of prayers. And the power of prayer is meaningful conversation with God, not just a shopping list. And my brothers and sisters, it is time for us to reclaim back this power of prayer, to rebuild our prayer life. Last but not least, we will move on to the third point, the third step of Paul, how he would deal and cope with hardships and difficulties. And for this, we will say, well, what do we do after prayer? Because after step two, which is in everything and everything, commit to God in a meaningful prayer conversation style. And this first step, this is what I would call is the waiting time. Because we may have followed the first two steps. Rejoice in the Lord, trust in him in everything. And then we pray to him for everything, even with action plans, we commit them to God. When we have done all of that, now we move on to this third stage, which is the waiting stage. And it is equally challenging because I'm sure in our very own experience, in your very own experience, countless times we have seen this happen again and again and again. At the beginning, it will still be okay. But after a while, those worries, anxieties, fears, anger, and everything, they start resurface again. Deeper the issue, the more complex a matter we are dealing with, we know in reality is it requires more time. It requires more time for things to sort of reveal itself, to take its path. And sometimes we also know is time is also required for God to really pull strings together to make things happen. But that is also the moment that we can get distracted one more time. We can even get discouraged or even impatient. It's just like this analogy I can find is sort of when we are baking a cake, okay, or roasting something, maybe a roast chicken, or even a steaming, simmering something. And the whole point is, the key is whether it's the oven or the steamer, we need to get it covered. But sometimes when we get impatient, We all keep on checking. How is it? The cake, okay, is it rising now? What is it? And sometimes we know the rule number one is no matter how impatient you are, no matter how you want to know what is going on inside, but never ever open the door. Or at least don't open it for too long or for too often, because the heat trap will be gone and so on and so forth. But using this same analogy, brothers and sisters, so often we find ourselves doing the exact thing. Once we have submitted everything to God, action plans put into place, and now we are waiting, the waiting game, we got impatient. Just like we are checking the oven, and every now and then we are so tempted to open the door, lift the lid, sort of. We try to take things into our control just to see how things are going. As a result, the cake or whatever thing we're cooking is not done properly. And sometimes we may even blame the oven for not working or the recipe to be not good enough. But in actual fact, maybe the problem is with us because we were too impatient. There are certain things that need time to evolve. So what shall we do? Verses 8 to 9, the finishing part of our passage. Verse 8 of Philippians 4. Finally, brothers and sisters, whatever is true, whatever is noble, whatever is right, whatever is pure, whatever is lovely, whatever is admirable, if anything is excellent or praiseworthy, think about such things. Whatever you have learned or received or heard from me, seen in me, put it into practice, and the God of peace will be with you. Key verse, of course, is verse 8. Like all this, like whatever is true, noble, right, pure, lovely, admirable, think about such thing. So in this first stage, Paul said the waiting time, what shall we do? Then Paul's answer, as in verse 8, is think of such things. Things that are true, that are noble, that are right, that are pure, so on and so forth. The concept here is fairly similar to how do we get rid of a bad habit. I'm sure we've all been through those processes. How do we get rid of a bad habit? Well, we don't just simply get rid of it, but then when it's been taken away, there is an empty void. For example, if my bad habit is for a certain time, maybe for 2 hours, okay, I am doing this thing that is unhealthy to me. Now my bad habit is I need to get rid of it. But as we all know, once it's gone, that 2 hours will still remain there as an empty time slot that needs to be filled in. And we know for getting rid of a bad habit, if we don't find something healthy, a good habit to replace, to fill in that 2 hours gap, the history will repeat itself. We will find ourselves in the same trouble. So likewise, here is the same concept that Paul is saying. During that waiting time, to put everything back into his context, which is prayer, what happens? Well, Paul is saying, finally, do these things. Fill your thoughts, your minds and your thoughts with these good things. Now, this is not only to ask us to be a good sort of a human being, okay? If we expand this, knowing it from scriptures, now Paul is not only saying, just do these good things, but it's fill our minds and our hearts with things that are godly. Like what are true, noble, right, pure, lovely, admirable, excellent, praiseworthy. Of course, the whole context is things that are pleasing to God. Things and matters that God cares about. That is what Paul is asking us to do. During this waiting time, how to safeguard us from sort of relapsing into the trouble itself, Paul is saying, well, we need to replace them with something godly. Now, broaden this. This is not simply saying, fill this up so that we are not being triggered or we don't relapse. But there's even a deeper reason to that, a more important reason to that. It's because when we fill up our mind and heart with godly things, things that God cares about, things that matters to God, what in fact is happening is God is helping us to broaden our mind and horizon. Because brothers and sisters, as we know, that's how troubles, anxiety and fears work. When we are facing those issues, when we are in the middle of it, in the midst of it, the common problem, the trend we have is we tend to, human nature, we tend to magnify the situation. We tend to cocoon ourselves, like isolate ourselves, build a high wall of fortress around us. And then everything will become so self-centered, so self-absorbed, like we find ourselves in this sort of a grudge, a misery, and even if we're not careful, self-pity. That is a very common human behavior. When we find ourselves in the bigger, the deeper the trouble is, we will further magnify it to make it become the whole world to us. Brothers and sisters, verses 8 to 9, therefore, especially in verse 8, what Paul is saying there is not just filled up with godly stuff, but because we filled our heart and mind with godly matters, that in turn help us to broaden the horizon, help us not to be self-centered, self-absorbed, but God-centered. So that by the grace of God, we can see we are not unique in our hardships. Everybody else is going through tough times as well. But God is here for us and with us. By the grace of God, that we will be victorious. It is essential and vital for us to be able to look beyond ourselves. As I said, otherwise we will constantly be in this self-destruction mode, which is very unhealthy. And not only unhealthy, but destructive. Moving from self-centered to God-centered, able to see beyond ourselves, able therefore to see and help others, to shine for Christ, to setting this Christian example and testimony for God. Because Christian testimony, especially Christian testimony in the midst of troubles and difficulties, it was never about us being perfect. Like showing to people, seeing we Christians were immune to trouble, so how perfect we are, holy saints. It was never like that. What it has always been for us is Christian testimony is to show to people around us, we too, Christian likewise, we will go through the same trials and difficulties. But the difference is how we cope and how we deal with it with Christ as our God, with Christ as our center. Apostle Paul in 2 Timothy chapter 4, verses 6 to 8, like one of his final words, he said, "For I am already being poured out like a drink offering, and the time for my departure is near. I have fought the good fight, I have finished the race, I have kept the faith. Now there is in store for me the crown of righteousness, which the Lord, the righteous judge, will award to me on that day. And not only to me, but also to all who have longed for his appearing." So you see in this passage there, Paul is using this language, fighting the fight, running the race. So Paul is saying there is sweat and toil, brothers and sisters. There are efforts and endurance involved. But how did he do that? Just like in our passage, by trusting in God, but ultimately God helping him to see beyond his very own circumstances. Paul here is using life as an analogy. Race as an analogy to life. And very often we think like the race as an analogy is a 100-meter sprint, kind of like a straight line, no obstacle, and the race will be done within 10 seconds. Well, these days world record is below that. But reality shows us it is not a 100-meter sprint with no obstacle at all. In fact, it is a hurdle race. And it's not even a 110-meter hurdle race, but it's still a sprint. But reality tells us what Paul meant by he run the race, I believe it's more closer, if we watch the Olympic Games, it's much closer to the 10K steeplechase. So I'm sure you've seen those, the 10K, like 10,000 meters run, which in itself is already a killing, okay? But on top of that steeplechase, meaning you've seen those massive hurdle that every now and then they need to jump over, as if the run, the kind of like semi-marathon is not already killing them. The hurdle they need to jump against, all tiring. That is our life, real life. Challenges will always be with us. But yet, in God we trust. Countless Christians have walked this path before us, brothers and sisters in Christ. And countless Christians are at this present moment are walking with us together. We are all living in this world. We are all facing trials and difficulties. So therefore, may we trust in God, because our Lord Jesus Christ never forsake us, never abandon us. Summing up this third point is, during this waiting time, fill our heart and our mind with godly matters, with things that God cares about, and that will lead us away from being a self-centered, self-absorbed point of view to a God-centered point of view, and that will enrich us, will really help us to still be effective, still be fruitful in our life, in our Christian life, despite what troubles and difficulties we are going through. So to summarize, in summary of the entire sermon, what we're going through, three steps from Paul. Step number one, as he said, in anything and everything, rejoice in the Lord. But that rejoicing is not about just keep on smiling and be happy, but having this inner strength that comes from God. But that will be expressed outwardly through actions such as gentleness, kindness, love, and patience. Step number one. Step number two, Paul says, in everything and anything, pray and pray and pray to God. But prayer not kind of like a model answer type of prayer we make, but more of a meaningful conversation with God. So let us rediscover the power of prayer. Last but not least, the third step is, while we dedicate ourselves, while we engage with God and submit everything to Him, action plans and all, during that waiting time, waiting for God to work things out for us, in those moments, let us fill our heart and mind with godly matters, with matters that God cares about. And that in turn, God also help us to be able to move beyond our own troubles, our own self-centered view, but into a God-centered view. So let's end with a word of prayer. Let us all bow down our heads and pray together. Let's pray. Dear God, dear Lord Jesus Christ, we come before you again, Lord, as we have learned from Apostle Paul today, God, three ways how to learn to deal and cope with our difficulties and hardships. But God, we pray that you will teach us and be able to apply them into our daily life. It's not easy, but God, you are here to help us through, to encourage us, Lord, to guide us through. And God, in you we trust. Thank you so much for listening to our prayers. In the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, we pray. Amen. So today it is the first Sunday of the month of November, and therefore it is also our Holy Communion service. So now let's prepare our hearts and minds for the Holy Communion by singing the following hymns, When I Survey the Wondrous Cross. Charm me most. In the Bible, 1 Corinthians chapter 11, verses 23 to 29, it says, "For I received from the Lord what I also passed on to you. The Lord Jesus, on the night he was betrayed, took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, 'This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me.' In the same way, after supper, he took the cup, saying, 'This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this whenever you drink it, in remembrance of me. For whenever you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes.' So then, whoever eats the bread or drinks the cup of the Lord in an unworthy manner will be guilty of sinning against the body and blood of the Lord. Everyone ought to examine themselves before they eat of the bread and drink from the cup. For those who eat and drink without discerning the body of Christ eat and drink judgment on themselves." Let us spend a quiet time of prayer so that we can one more time confess our sin to our Lord Jesus Christ, asking for his forgiveness and also asking for the power of repentance from him. Let's spend some time in prayers. Let's pray together. Dear God, dear Lord Jesus Christ, we come before you again, Lord. We humble ourselves before you. And Lord Jesus, we ask and pray that we confess our sins to you, all the wrongdoings we've done, Lord, whether intentional or not, God. We confess to you and we pray and seek for your forgiveness. But we also, by the power of your resurrection, Lord, we pray for repentance so that, God, we can truly change over, so that we in turn, we can make a difference. We can make changes, Lord, to the world, to the place that you have put us in. In Jesus Christ's name we pray. Amen. Let us have our bread and cup ready for the Holy Communion. As the Holy Communion reminds us of the great salvation of our Lord Jesus Christ, how our Lord Jesus Christ, through his death and resurrection on the cross, saved us from the sin, saved us from the penalty of sin, saved us from the power of sin, and saved us from the presence of sin. Therefore, we would like to encourage Christians, brothers and sisters in Christ, who have openly declared and professed our Christian faith in our Lord Jesus Christ through water baptism, to take part with us in the Holy Communion. But for the brothers and sisters in Christ, Christians who haven't received the Holy water baptism, or our non-Christian friends, may I kindly ask you not to take part in the Holy Communion, but maybe use this following time to think about the meaning of water baptism and the meaning of accepting our Lord Jesus Christ as our personal Lord and Savior. So for those Christians, brothers and sisters in Christ who are taking part in the Holy Communion, may I ask you to stand up. In the scriptures, in the Gospel of Matthew chapter 26, verse 26, it says, "While they were eating, Jesus took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, 'Take and eat, this is my body.'" Let's take the bread together with a thankful heart. Likewise, in the Gospel of Matthew chapter 26, verse 27, it says, "Then he took a cup, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, 'Drink from it, all of you. This is my blood of the covenant, which is poured out for many for the forgiveness of sin.'" Let's take this cup together with a thankful heart. Let us pray. Dear God, dear Lord Jesus Christ, we give thanks to you, God, one more time for your great sacrifice, for your great salvation that you have achieved upon the cross to save us, Lord, that while we were still sinners, you came and you died for us. And Lord Jesus, for this, we give thanks to you and we praise you forever. But God, we also pray that you will teach us how to trust you at all times, but also how to be a powerful, effective Christian witness testimony for you, for your glory's sake. In the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, we give thanks and pray. Amen. So let's all stand up to receive the blessing from above. Let's all bow down our heads. May the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, may the eternal love and mercy of our Heavenly Father, may the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all from now on till forever. Amen. Please take a seat. So this is the end of our Sunday service. After your own quiet meditation or personal prayer with God, you may end the service. But may I also encourage you to join our online fellowship via Zoom that will be starting very, very soon. So please do come and join us so that we can say hi, we can pray, but we can also extend our care and support for one another. So one more time, take good care of yourself, and we shall see you again next Sunday. May God bless you.
See how great